Penguin Random House Audio presents 0 to 1, Notes on Startups or How to Build the Future by Peter Thiel with Blake Masters. Preface, 0 to 1. Every moment in business happens only once. The next Bill Gates will not build an operating system. The next Larry Page or Sergey Brin won't make a search engine. And the next Mark Zuckerberg won't create a social network. If you're copying these guys, you aren't learning from them. Of course, it's easier to copy a model than to make something new. Doing what we already know how to do takes the world from 1 to N, adding more of something familiar. But every time we create something new, we go from 0 to 1. The act of creation is singular, as is the moment of creation, and the result is something fresh and strange. Unless they invest in the difficult task of creating new things, American companies will fail in the future, no matter how big their profits remain today. What happens when we've gained everything to be had from fine-tuning the old lines of business that we've inherited? Unlikely as it sounds, the answer threatens to be far worse than the crisis of 2008. Today's so-called best practices lead to dead ends. The best paths are new and untried. In a world of gigantic administrative bureaucracies, both public and private, searching for a new path might seem like hoping for a miracle. Actually, if American business is going to succeed, we're going to need hundreds or even thousands of miracles. This would be depressing, but for one crucial fact. Humans are distinguished from other species by our ability to work miracles. We call these miracles technology. Technology is miraculous because it allows us to do more with less, ratcheting up our fundamental capabilities to a higher level. Other animals are instinctively driven to build things like dams or honeycombs, but we are the only ones that can invent new things and better ways of making them. Humans don't decide what to build by making choices from some cosmic catalog of options given in advance. Instead, by creating new technologies, we rewrite the plan of the world. These are the kind of elementary truths we teach to second graders, but they are easy to forget in a world where so much of what we do is repeat what has been done before. 0 to 1 is about how to build companies that create new things. It draws on everything I've learned directly as a co-founder of PayPal and Palantir, and then an investor in hundreds of startups, including Facebook and SpaceX. But while I've noticed many patterns, and I relate them here, this book offers no formula for success. The paradox of teaching entrepreneurship is that such a formula necessarily cannot exist. Because every innovation is new and unique, no authority can prescribe in concrete terms how to be innovative. Indeed, the single most powerful pattern that I've noticed is that successful people find value in unexpected places. And they do this by thinking about business from first principles instead of formulas. This book stems from a course about startups that I taught at Stanford in 2012. College students can become extremely skilled at a few specialties, but many never learn what to do with those skills in the wider world. My primary goal in teaching the class was to help my students see beyond the tracks laid down by academic specialties to the broader future that is theirs to create. One of those students, Blake Masters, took detailed class notes, which circulated far beyond the campus, and in 0 to 1, I've worked with him to revise the notes for a wider audience. There's no reason why the future should happen only at Stanford, or in college, or in Silicon Valley. Chapter 1. The Challenge of the Future. Whenever I interview someone for a job, I like to ask this question: what important truth do very few people agree with you on? This question sounds easy because it's straightforward. Actually, it's very hard to answer. It's intellectually difficult because the knowledge that everyone is taught in school is, by definition, agreed upon. And it's psychologically difficult because anyone trying to answer must say something she knows to be unpopular. Brilliant thinking is rare, but courage is an even shorter supply than genius. Most commonly, I hear answers like the following. Our educational system is broken and urgently needs to be fixed. America is exceptional. There is no God. Those are bad answers. The first and the second statements might be true, but many people already agree with them. The third statement simply takes one side in a familiar debate. A good answer takes the following form. Most people believe in X, but the truth is the opposite of X. I'll give my own answer later this chapter. What does this contrarian question have to do with the future? In the most minimal sense, the future is simply the set of all moments yet to come. But what makes the future distinctive and important isn't that it hasn't happened yet, but rather that it will be a time when the world looks different from today. In this sense, if nothing about our society changes for the next 100 years, then the future is over 100 years away. If things change radically in the next decade, then the future is nearly at hand. No one can predict the future exactly, but we know two things. It's going to be different, and it must be rooted in today's world. Most answers to the contrarian question are different ways of seeing the present. Good answers are as close as we can come to looking into the future. 0 to 1, the future of progress. When we think about the future, we hope for a future of progress. That progress can take one of two forms. Horizontal or extensive progress means copying things that work, going from 1 to n. Horizontal progress is easy to imagine because we already know what it looks like. Vertical or intensive progress means doing new things, going from 0 to 1. Vertical progress is harder to imagine because it requires doing something nobody else has ever done. If you take one typewriter and build 100, you've made horizontal progress. If you have a typewriter and build a word processor, you have made vertical progress. At the macro level, the single word for horizontal progress is globalization, taking things that work somewhere and making them work everywhere. China is the paradigmatic example of globalization. Its 20-year plan is to become like the United States is today. The Chinese have been straightforwardly copying everything that has worked in the developed world. 19th century railroads, 20th century air conditioning, and even entire cities. They might skip a few steps along the way, going straight to wireless without installing landlines, for instance, but they're copying all the same. The single word for vertical, 0 to 1 progress is technology. The rapid progress of information technology in recent decades has made Silicon Valley the capital of technology in general. But there's no reason why technology should be limited to computers. Properly understood, any new and better way of doing things is technology. Because globalization and technology are different modes of progress, it's possible to have both, either, or neither at the same time. For example, 1815 to 1914 was a period of both rapid technological development and rapid globalization. Between the First World War and Kissinger's trip to reopen relations with China in 1971, there was rapid technological development, but not much globalization. Since 1971, we have seen rapid globalization, along with limited technological development, mostly confined to IT. This age of globalization has made it easy to imagine that the decades ahead will bring more convergence and more sameness. Even our everyday language suggests we believe in a kind of technological end of history. The division of the world into the so-called developed and developing nations implies that the developed world has already achieved the achievable and that poorer nations just need to catch up. But I don't think that's true. My own answer to the contrarian question is that most people think the future of the world will be defined by globalization, but the truth is that technology matters more. Without technological change, if China doubles its energy production over the next 2 decades, it'll also double its air pollution. If every one of India's hundreds of millions of households were to live the way Americans already do, using only today's tools, the result would be environmentally catastrophic. Spreading old ways to create wealth around the world will result in devastation.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.